that's cool. Yeah. Thank you for coming to the dumbest idea I've ever had. This was insanely difficult. I'm Mike Seliger. I'm the designer of the Pathfinder Adventure Card Game. I've known some other games like Astonishing Revise and Lords of Vegas and Pathfinder from Betrayal of House on the Hill and stuff like that. So, and I've played a lot of games in my life. It is a challenge to think of all the games that that you have played in your life. So I asked some friends, 250 of them. They gave me 1,400 possible answers to the question, what are the 100 games you absolutely, positively must know how to play? Most of them were wrong. Many of them were right, and too many of them fit into a list of 100, but we got close. But I want to throw some ground rules down. I want to make sure that, that we're not all thinking about different requirements for these games. So, and I'll just sort of say that there's some key elements that you need to consider. First, not the best games. There's lots of things. That's on you, right? What you like, if you really like it, awesome, it's great, it's on your 100, it's not online. It's not the most important games. There are things that are critical in history that you don't really know how to play. But you kind of know they exist, and they'll be in this panel, but I think it's not required that you walk into a room and know it. But this is important. Some of these games aren't as much fun as I'd like. But you should know how to play. This is the requirement. You often walk into rooms, right? You're the kind of people who do that?
I do walk into
rooms. If you walk into a room and say, oh, see, they're half there. You walk into a room and say, I don't know how to play X. Everybody looks at you and says, dude, it's probably on this list. If it's not, if it doesn't happen, it's probably not on this list. I know you're going to have opinions, so I'm going to kill some things right now. I'm just going to shoot them in the head, and if that takes you out as well, so be it. Go ahead.
Are you going to justify it, though?
Why would I do that?
All right.
Couple things. I'm not putting the things people have been playing for 500 years on the list. So, none of these. If you need me to tell you to know how to play backgammon or go or shotgun, you didn't need to come here for that, right? You know how to play a pinball game. These are important games. I mean, it's not like we don't want to know about how to play horse and Impala, but they're not on this. I didn't look at historical impact. Historical impact is important, but it is not the subject of why you need to know how to play it. So, I apologize. It's not on the list. These are all wonderful things. We're not here if this doesn't happen. But that doesn't mean you don't know, you need to know how to play it. If you feel that you need to know how to play Doom to play Halo, you're wrong. It's important. It's not on the list. Just because it's a game doesn't mean you need to know how to play it to play it. And so these games are not on the list. I would like them to be. But they are not.
Wow!
I know.
The natives are getting restless.
I know. Do you think the tribal council is going to let me continue, or am I going to be burned at the stake right now?
You're good.
Well, this will do it.
Oh.
This is not.
Wow.
If the aforementioned Zeb walked into the room and said, guys, I don't know how to play Monopoly, you wouldn't teach him. Yep.
Good point.
So it's not on the list. I will have a replacement for this later. And the last one, the last caveat, I apologize to you personally. I didn't want your game. I know you spent a lot of time on it. It's a short list. Maybe next time. That doesn't apply to everybody in the audience, and it certainly doesn't apply to me. I had a real, like, somebody was like, you're not going to put your own stuff on there, right? I'm going to put my own stuff on there. I've worked on a lot of things. So let's get it started. I've broken it down by categories. You'll see all these words again, but this was sort of, you're going to find that some things bleed from one thing to another. Live with it. Nobody's going to jail, son. But this is sort of this is all the things I'm going to cover. Don't worry. Oh, you don't need to take notes. At the end of this, I will give you a handout. You have a checklist that you can compare your knowledge to mine. Good luck. But I encourage you at the end of this to make your own list and post it to the internet and point out where I was wrong. So, let's get started on these. I'm going to start with tabletop RPGs. If this is not your list, you should probably. I don't care what you call this. I don't care whether it has a number in it. I don't care whether it has a decimal point in it. I don't care whether you call it Pathfinder or Call of Cthulhu or Traveler or anything else. You need to know what happens when a game master sits in front of you and weaves a story in front of you and you build a character up from its low ranks to its super powerful form. This is the most important form of gaming you will ever do. So if you haven't done it, find somebody who will teach you. Nothing else in this category on the list. All the rest of the games I just said are important. They don't make the cut, but this one does. This is a very different style of gaming. Vampire takes everything I just said, put a game master in front of you, work your character up, and says it's not relevant. We're going to get together and we're going to weave a story together that involves us making the best possible story. It's not the same form of art at all, but it is something that you need to know how to do. And when you get done with that, and you will be done with that, you will go to this game. This is not a participation panel. Please feel free to applaud, boo, throw things away. You may not play this game. Fiasco is a game where you build scenes together, and there's this thing called impulses, where you get a story that you're all participating to make. Like, nobody wrote this for you. It represents sort of a genre of tabletop games that there are many other great ones in. I encourage you to explore this direction because it's super fun and you look super hip when you do it. This game is the best way to get anyone else into RPGs who somehow missed the first three of these. This is Mouseguard.
Yeah!
Mouseguard is the single best RPG of the last 10 years. You get to play these little mouse rangers who go out and everything in the world is bigger than them and will kill them. That's awesome. That's super fun. But it also teaches you how to play differently. It teaches you that that the character that you have is not necessarily the most important thing in the world, but it's still the most important thing to you. It's the sort of inverse reaction of Dungeons & Dragons where you are the center of everything. And finally, in the tabletop RPG category, you should know how to get a whole lot of people to play an RPG at once, and that's why you need this game. This game has been out for a very long time, but it is the quintessential way to throw a party. If you want people to come over to your house and enjoy themselves, this is a very good place to start. You throw a murder mystery, and somebody in the room killed the victim, and you have to find them out. And you can do that 5 seconds into their arrival. So I encourage you to continue looking at tabletop RPGs as much as you like. I'm going to switch to a different kind of RPG, and sometimes it doesn't feel like the same kind of action because you're often playing by yourself, but there's a lot of similarities to these things. I'm going to start the electronic RPGs with slightly breaking a rule on history, but I feel like this game holds up, and you should know how to play it for the cultural touchstones that matter in it, and that is Zork. You already accomplished step one, you entered a room. This is basically the best room entering game of all time. it's a text adventure, and so it covers, covers things like Colossal Cave, and lots of other games that are in this category, Leisure Suit Larry, all these things like that. But this one, I think, somehow manages to be still the best one that was ever made. Eventually, we got graphics. And this happened. Really, the colon and everything after that is not terribly relevant. I think Aubrey the Clown is the best in this series, but that doesn't mean that that you might not have a different opinion. At some point, you should be a little elf in a green hat that shoots something with an arrow. And so, this is the only one of this generation of games that's on the list. At some point, electronic RPGs started to have more than just a point-and-click story to them. They got themselves immersed in an environment where you just said, I want to be there. And this was when it happened. Monkey Island, and it's a series of games. They're all available now. I think I got it on my phone now. It's pretty amazing. But it wasn't the first time games were funny. It's the first time you were funny with the game. And so you'll find that you'll see Monkey Island references all the time. My dog is named Guybrush Threepwood. So just knowing why that's the case and why people will come up to you and say, you fight like a dairy farmer, and I will respond with, is certainly why you should know the jokes in this game. It's kind of like knowing, it's kind of like saying, oh, I haven't seen Ghostbusters. Right? If you don't know this game, you can't play along. All right, at the point at which RPGs became real games, I was stunned at how unanimous the number was in this one, but I sure was confident it was going to be the one that made the list. I won't specify a number because the games all bleed together, but this game isn't like that. This game, every game is a different story. Final Fantasy certainly said, we're going to go a different direction every time, and in this one, well, I can't tell you why if you haven't played the game, but you will cry. So, if you can find a PlayStation, put it in. It's probably on my phone. I love Diablo 3, and it's undoubtedly a better game, but there's something missing at the heart of it that is in Diablo 2. Diablo 2 is inventory management 101. It is like, I'm going to go and do a thing, I'm going to put something in my backpack. Oh wait, I don't have room in my backpack. Like, I cannot tell you how much time I spent playing this game. But there are games since then that have done this kind of thing. I feel like there was a reasonable chance, that every single game that Blizzard ever made would make this list. It didn't quite happen, but this one certainly, if you can find a copy, try it. Otherwise, certainly play Diablo 3. It's a fantastic game. This is standing in for at least five other games. I like this one the best, but if you want to call this Dragon Age Inquisition, my dear friends at BioWare will not object. They, after all, we run the BioWare base, so I would like them to you to call it whatever you want. But Mass Effect 2 was, for me, like, in terms of immersing you in an environment and making you play a character all the way to things that you didn't think you would normally ever do in a video game, There's romance, there's complex moral decisions that, quite honestly, none of them are clearly right. I think that these guys pushed it over the edge in a way that I don't think I'd ever seen before, until this happened. Up until this point, sound and music and artistry were all sort of things that happened when a game designer was done with their game, right? They'd written it all out and said, all right, I know exactly what it does, and now I need somebody to score it. And now I need somebody to design the color palette for it. That didn't happen in Journey. Austin Wintory's musical score and the gorgeous landscape that you're in, the colors of your outfits and so forth. This game may have been it doesn't look realistic at all, and yet it's the single most realistic video game I've ever played because it engaged every one of my senses that it could engage. This next game on the list, though, is the most immersive game you will ever play. For me, it's a role-playing game. For other people, it is not.
Huh.
Depression Quest is a game about being depressed. It does not have a satisfactory resolution. It launched one of the dumbest things that has ever happened in the game industry. And I'm not going to go into that in terms of its importance, but at the very least, you should play the game that caused the Gamergate controversy. Because if you're not suffering from depression, you should know what it feels like. If you are suffering from depression, you should know that other people feel like that too. And so I highly, highly recommend this game. I know not a lot of people have tried it, but I strongly recommend it. Okay. Into another category. Sometimes your brain is something you have to learn how to train. These are how you got smart. These are deduction games. These are games where being the smartest person in the room is actually an advantage. You know this game. You may not know this game. This is Zendo. Zendo, and there's a whole line of Ice House games that my dear friend, who's a front row, Andy Lemmy, has created. Zendo is created by
Corey Heath.
My apologies. Zendo is a game with Ice House pyramids are just various heights and colors of pyramids, and the goal in Zendo is to create a Zen koan in which the other people playing must guess what the rule you used to define that koan was. I know, seriously. But if you can analyze Zendo, you can analyze anything else in the world. So I strongly recommend it. This game is also a deduction game. I don't like it as much. And I'm going to turn to my friend Andy here. This game, if you haven't played it, you have to play it. I mean, you just have to play it. It's the only game you can play with 14 of your friends and still actually have a true interactive experience. There are frustrating elements of it. I find that my method of playing this game is to be killed in the first 5 minutes. That's the rest of the game you play. That's my strength. At least that's, if you look at how much I played it, that's exactly how it goes for me. Andy has fixed this game in a game called Are You the Traitor, which I recommend even more, but you should know how to play this game. But another way this game was fixed, and there's a whole line of games that are associated with this, is is to just bring it down a little bit, to give people a little more rationale for who they are, and to pit them against each other in an absolutely bloodthirsty spy situation. These games, Werewolf Mafia, The Resistance, if you have too many friends, this is a good way to solve it. But there's a better way coming, which I will show you in a minute. All right. I'm going to switch to tile games. Acquire is the Ur tile game. It is, you build a hotel chain, essentially, and you want it to be the biggest and the most profitable and so forth. These games, you'll note the box, these are the original 3M boxes. They're kind of antiquated. Like, I wrote a game with James Ernest called Lords of Vegas. And Lords of Vegas is probably a better game than Acquire. I know I can't really say that. Like, I mean, that's like saying my band is better than Beatles, right? But it certainly learned from Acquire. There's no way Lords of Vegas knocks Acquire off the list. Twix, you may not have heard of. Twix is a game where you're connecting lines of pegs across a board. If you've played Blokus, then you've sort of played Twix. Twix is better though. Twix is a game where you just have to get from one side of the board to another. That is incredibly difficult when other people are messing with you along the way. I don't think I need to talk much about these next two games, so I'm not going to. You should know how to play These are the ideal tile games. Nobody has actually done much better than them. There's one other game that fits in the tile game category that I didn't have any hesitation about putting on the list, despite the fact that I might be a little bit associated with it. This took the tile game concept and said, you know what we can do? We can let you go out and explore and put this board that you don't know what it's going to look like when you're done, and then we're going to take one of the people playing and turn them into the bad guy. This concept has been explored in lots of other ways. I had real trouble getting this game published. It seems like it's gotten to mini classic status, which is awesome. I hope Wizards sometimes decides to make another version of it. We had a whole line planned of like Betrayal at Ice Station Zebra and stuff like that. It would be great if there was more of this, because this is a super fun game, and I'm glad I got to be at least a little bit associated with it. Speaking of tiles, I'm going to switch to a different category, tabletop puzzle games. I know you know how to play this game. I don't know that you know how to play this game. So, Can't Stop is the game in which all you have to do is get your little pegs from one end of the board to the other end of the board. And it's very simple. All you have to do is roll some dice, put some numbers on them, and if your number shows up, you get to move your little peg. And if you decide to do that in a calm, considerate manner, you will lose every single game. So I want you to play this game. I know you can't find a copy on shelves, so all I want you to do is download the app for your iPad. Because you will play almost nothing else. Almost. My mathematician friend Robert says about this next game, the brain cells that you devote to it cannot be used for anything else. Sometimes it teaches you a different set of skills. By the way, this is a very hard game to search for on Google. The word set shows up a lot. Sometimes you need to know when things are all the same, like those are all of my cards. Sometimes you need to know when things are different, like one of those cards is on fire. Sometimes you need to know when the things are both the same and different at the same time. So all of those are my cards, one of them is on fire and I'm not going to drive it. That is what this game teaches you. These squiggles and symbols, all you have to do is determine which of them is, you need to get a match or a lack of match on four different axes. You can see that, for example, the lozenge shaped ones, you've got one shaded, two full, and three unshaded in different colors, right? So once you can get good at that, you can use that skill for, well, nothing. This game, Robo Rally, is a puzzle game. You build yourself a little robot's pattern of movement, and then you put it into play. But the problem is everybody else has done that too, and when your robot encounters somebody else's robot, it might just move you one square over, and that's the precipice of doom, and you fall up and die. So program, this will teach you about the value of programming. Sometimes when you put things down on paper, it all looks like it works, and then it meets contact with the enemy, that is other people. And so this is the best summary of that I've ever seen. All right, we're moving along to electronic puzzle games. No surprise here. These are the words from Russia with fun. This one you may not have heard of, but I want you to find a copy. You have to know that us Macintosh users, back in the day, prized anything that was Mac compatible beyond anything else. And this game, The Fool's Errand, is the single best puzzle game that has ever been created. And I know you know what the next thing on the next slide is, so I'm still going to say this is the best puzzle game ever created. It is by Cliff Johnson. You immerse yourself into a world of a fool who has a tarot deck, and you have to solve all these brain-bending puzzles. Cliff promised a sequel right away afterwards. It took him 25 years to deliver it.
Wow.
It is fantastic. Please find it and play it. Meantime, you can get this on your iPhone. I speak highly of the original, I don't speak as highly of the sequels, but simply being able to poke around an island and try to remember which switch caused the observatory to turn in the right position, it was over on the other side of the island, so I have to make notes. This teaches you how to make notes to yourself in the middle of a game. Highly recommended. I mentioned that Trivial Pursuit didn't make the list. This does. Because you don't need to know how to play it. You just pick up a card and start reading it. You're playing the game better than actually if you use the pie pieces. But this game, you actually need to know what's going on. You need to know, you need to get better at words flying at you and all the different games that are embedded in it. I believe it's still being made for Facebook and other platforms. I don't need to tell you that you need to know how to play the Match 3 game, because you know how to play the Match 3 game. But this next game, you should know by the name it has. It's called Freeze. It's not called 2048.
Absolutely.
2048 was stolen from these guys who made it. Freeze is a game that you can play. I came to it late. My wife was playing it constantly, and I was like, do you have to know math to do this? And the answer is, certainly doesn't hurt. But it is maybe one of the best time-wasting games I've ever seen. This next game is definitely, might be considered a role-playing game. I think it's a puzzle game. Because I think I just like it better. I mean, I like Portal 2, I think it's great. And Half-Life isn't on here, so it should probably be on here too, but whatever. Portal is about, I don't even tell you what Portal is about. Play Portal, you know, if you haven't played it, for God's sake, play it. This next game, I was trying to figure out what Nintendo DS game was going to make it, because I thought that was a really important genre of games, and this is the one that did. Love this game. I love the concept that you can just hit a word and it will happen. But it is a really complex puzzle game. It's not just draw something, right? This is the reason to own a DS, as far as I know. Okay, the next category is platforms. Only one from the classic period. Only one. But it matters. Version number, pretty important. I think it's pretty clear it's 3, but if you just play Super Mario Bros., it's fine. Anything in this series is great, but know what it was like. Know what it was like to play that game. This game also had later iterations, but I think I like the original best. It's a programming game. You just need to move forward through your plan. Unfortunately, in this particular particular case, things will die. Your plan is bad. I feel pretty confident you've played those games. I don't know if you've played this. I really hope you have, because this is maybe the single most touching game that has ever been made. The princess is not in another castle here. The princess needs to be guided out of this horrible maze of shadow demons by you, a 10-year-old devil-horned boy. And the only way you can get her out is to hold her hand. If you let go, she's not gonna make it. Oh my God, I cannot believe how, like, there was no way we were turning on the lights. Like, I mean, my wife and I played this, and it is a bonding experience between any two people who love each other. Play this game. There's another game they made called Shadows of the Colossus, which you might have played. It's fantastic, but it's not this game. In a slightly different tone. Violent game of all time. Yeah. Doom has nothing on this. Everything falls to your will. You can roll up the Eiffel Tower. You can roll. I mean, it's fantastic. Sometimes, once you turn that down, you want to build it back up. And that's why LEGO Star Wars is on this. LEGO Star Wars. There's many other games on this line. I like this one, but. It's the only game I've ever tried to get 100% complete on because, I mean, it's LEGOs, for God's sake. Everything's awesome. These next two games are not quite in the same state of joy as the last two. This is a very frustrating game. That's okay. You can be frustrated. It's a game. But it's a game, if you guys have played Prince of Persia, Sands of Time, or something like that, where you've had the ability to manipulate time, that's nothing like what happens in this game. You have to think about every way you want to play the game and then unplay it to make the game happen. The platform of Xbox Live became an environment on which you could see games like this, Elo and Milo, and other fantastic games that could never have come out and never really captured an audience. And this one defined the platform. I'm not sure I ever want to play this game again. Because it's scary. Everything is black. Except you. A little bit of light, and one giant spider. Has anyone else, I love spiders, but has anyone else just never wanted to turn on the TV again after playing the book? I know I did. Play this game. The next category is simulators. It's a really rough category, but it's all video games where you're building something. There's a board game with the same name. It takes 8 hours to play. So does this one, but there was a point where I flew to Chicago to work with FASA on BattleTech, and I borrowed a company laptop and somebody had put Civilization on it, and at the end of the flight, I deleted it from the laptop because building a world will take up all your time. And I wasn't necessarily going to put this next one, and then Electronic Arts forced my hand. I mean, come on, EA. In the concept of building a world, the Sims category of games, and this one I think is the best that you can argue a lot of different ways, is an important thing to get good at. This next one is also building a world. in that world to destroy everything around you, like massive bugs. I don't have Warcraft on the list, but it's the same kind of game. Now we're all agreed this is cool, right? Like this process of building an army and sending it out to defeat your foes in a battle landscape, we all like that, right? Well, why don't we all like this? This is the same game. I guess it is cursed, I get that.
There you go.
But that's a meter. Powder blue profiles, those are awesome. So anyway, I get it. Some of you don't like sports. This is a fantastic game. This is a game which you can play with your friends. You don't have to like anything about football, but it is a game you should know how to play. That is also true about this next game, specifically, sometimes the opposite side of the aisle. A lot of people do not like this game. I don't care. Play this game. Know what happens when they release a new goat. It changes You need to know what it's like to take care of something, right? I mean, to actually follow through with your promises to a virtual environment.
Tamagotchi,
absolutely. It's all Tamagotchi's around. And the same is true for this. In this one, you don't have to care. In this one, you could blow up the world. But yes, I mean, these building games, they teach you different strategies. They teach you how to manipulate your life better. They also take a whole lot of time. These next games don't take a lot of time. In the traditional card game category, it really helps if you want to be a classic to have a very short name. Starting with this. Can't not know. This next game, though, may have fallen off the radar. I hope it's not just on here for historical reasons. I do think that it is an important style of game because it's high speed and energetic. I think that this is a game about trading commodities with each other at super high speed. Now, unfortunately, the little bit I'm using my 1920s covered version of it. At one point, Hasbro decided that they should change the names of some of the commodities. And so, for example, they took out flax and replaced it with coffee. There's another commodity in the game called corn, which also begins with CO, so this game is ruined. So find an older version of the game, because it is a fantastic game. I don't have spades, I don't have hearts on here, because I can't own those games. But you do need this one. This is the best trick-taking game that has ever been made. You will play hours and hours of this game. It's vastly better than Bridge, vastly better than a number of games. So I highly recommend that you find it. It's very Mahjong-themed. It's got dragons, and so it feels like it fits into the fantasy genre, but it really is a fantastic trick-taking game. The next game is the best game about bean farming I have ever played. Bonanza is a game where you have a hand of cards, and you must not play them out of order, which changes everything. It's insane. More insane is Flux. Flux is a game where the rules change dramatically over the course of the game. There's another game later that the rules change even more, and you've probably never heard of it, but I'm going to introduce you to it. There's only one James Ernest game on here. It's called Falling. Falling is a real-time game where everybody is falling, and the only thing you can think of is to be the last one to hit the ground. It's a fantastic game. I very much encourage you to play it. You might have to find Brawl to be quite another game. Citadels is the first game where you got to be a character card, and that changed the way you play. We're going to find it again. Fantastic game. Gloom is a cards. And if you don't think that changes everything, you're obviously not paying attention. That the game is about killing your family members when they are unhappy. I don't think you can come up with a better thought for a game than that. Finally, in this category, know how to play this game, you should have one on you right now. Right? It's got 16 cards in it. That's it. And it is the best game for, like, if you're in a line and you need to get into a panel and they're not letting you in, this is the game you should have on. Some games, you'll note that these games are very short. Some games are a bit longer, and they fall into this category. challenges on this. I didn't put Netrunner, and I didn't put L5R, and I didn't put those on the list. They're great. They're phenomenal. They all sort of fall into this one. But this next game is a very different kind of deck construction game. But this may be the game I've played more than any other game in my life. Because it's also on the iPad, and I've played it probably 5 times a day since it came out. So, it is a fascinating way to play a very different kind of deck construction game. Everything changed when this game came out. There are many deck builders. You can find Legendary. You can find a lot of other ones that are fantastic. But I encourage you to start with the original. This one's going to be a little bit controversial. It has a lottery mechanic at the end that a lot of game designers do not like. It doesn't matter. It's great if you play it. The next deck builder. It was hard to get any other deck builders on here, actually, but this one, Antoine Bowser's Seven Wonders, is just fantastic. This is not a deck builder. This is a shuffle builder. You take two decks of different kinds and you put them together and play them. Very simple concept, Paul Peterson's game. Paul also worked on this next game. I don't have any hesitation of putting it on this list today. It might not be on the list, let's say, 3 years from now when something else takes place. But I'm going to put it on the list because I don't know any other game that does this. So you should learn how to play it. I mean, obviously, if you do, I am enriched beyond means. So I do not feel bad about that. But it may not make it forever. But for right now, for this captured moment, I think it's important enough. I'm going to switch to electronic action games again. I don't have a lot from the classic puzzle games, and this is the only racing game that's on there. You can play Need for Speed. At no point can you throw a turtle shell out the back. So I think this is the classic racing game. I only have one first-person shooter. Pick whatever version of this you want. Obviously, Call of Duty and Destiny and all that are fine, fantastic. Please play them. But I think this is the one you have to know how to play. But if you really want to know how to play a first-person shooter, if you really want to understand what it's like, this is how you have to play a game. You get into a battle and destroy everything around you. This door closes, and for the next 5 minutes, you are blowing up stuff inside a giant robot. You must find a way to play these. There's a few parlors still open. Please do so. I have one tower defense game on here. It's this one. You can make a strong case for D&D and so forth. That's fine. This is on every device I can. So I have this. I have back and forth on this versus Samurai Gun, which I think is a better game, and Nidhogg, which I think is a more fun game. But I think this is the sort of canonical, the game is going to happen whether you play or not game. And so I recommend. I had real trouble with this. Congregate is where the best games in the world happen. This one, I think, is the canonical one. The object of the game is to beat this scary monster here, this little black fellow. And to do so, all you have to do is burn the rope. Now, you have some axes, but they're useless. You have 30 seconds to do so, and if you don't, you lose. It is a fantastic game, but it is standing in for a whole lot of things. Just immerse yourself in congregating. The next category I call rhythm games. I don't know if it's a legit category, but I'm going to call it that for now. I think you at some point you have done this. Harmonix doesn't care. But this game, idea what a controller was. That is, I knew how to use a controller to play any sort of game, but this game taught me how to play it in time. It taught me how to match what the television wanted me to do. And no way Rock Band happens without Parappa the Rapper. So find it, play it on the PlayStation 1 if you can find it on it. This next category, there's another game that could take its spot. I like bigger games, so I'll pick this. Space Team is obviously the game that wanted to go here. I appreciate it, it's fantastic. I like this better. You need 5 iPads to play it. You're all members of a Starship Enterprise like crew, and things are coming at you at a million miles an hour, and any one of you can destroy the ship. It's a bad plan, don't do it. This is a really fun game to play in public. I hope you can find it and play it. Like I said, you need a lot of hardware. And speaking of hardware, you need a lot for this one, but you should find it and do it. Rand's gives you essentially a glow-in-the-dark or a light-up microphone, which you will lose if somebody else touches you or comes near you with theirs. You cannot move too fast, and you cannot move too slow. And so it's a physical game, but it's insanely popular right now. Who knows if it will be in 20 years, but I very much encourage you to try. I said that I would try to give you a replacement for Monopoly. This is it. It's a trap game. You roll some dice, you move your token, you pick up some resources along the way, and you try to spend them to become very powerful in the game and win. That's the same game as Monopoly, except this one is fun. What?
It's on Steam.
It's on Steam now? So depressing. if you haven't played this next game, I know why. It's cool. Whatever. Fix it. There's a lot of games that have sort of replaced it, and we don't really play Puerto Rico anymore, but it's a great board game and you should try it. This one you probably haven't played. It's fancy for all the train games that have come before it, but it's just better than all of them. This next game, Pandemic, is simply an immersive game where you try to save the world from a pandemic. You're not very good at it, and you probably fail. So, but it's a great cooperative game, probably the best cooperative game on the market. I don't know if this one sticks around, but I'm sure I do. It's certainly the most beautiful board game that's ever been created. You move across Japan, trying to go to all the hot springs and meet the loot players along the way. That's not a common subject for gaming. It's pretty good. And this was a little bit of controversial. I think we're going to still be playing Lords of Waterdeep in a long time. I think it's fantastic. In the war game category, I start with this. The hidden information game is in Fog of War has never been more beautifully done than Stratego. In Ogre, you are very much differently abled sides. One is a giant battle tank, the other is a whole bunch of little tanks. There's a $100 version that is colossal, will take up every table you ever own. Speaking of which, this one's probably going to get replaced by Memoir 44. I rebooted it in 2004, so I have a personal attachment to it, but I think it holds. Remember I said, though, that there's games where if you have too many friends, you can solve that problem? I don't think any game did it better than that. There are people I just simply will never talk to because of this game, because of the thing they did. It is a game of making promises and then somehow they don't quite work out. I have HeroClix on here. I think the whole genre of click bases might be a little bit of an artifact of the past, but all the information to play a character printed on the miniature is an insanely powerful force. I recommend it. The figures are fantastic. Now, you might be wondering why I didn't start this list with Risk. After all, I wrote Risk Godstorm, so I have something back on this. Because Risk may not actually be a very good game. This is. the game Risk wanted to be. You can customize it. It ends in a reasonable amount of time. You can write, if you succeed, you get new cards. You can write your name on the map and call Asia Mikeville if you want. I mean, it's fantastic. All right, open world video games is the next category. I have this. I understand when people say they don't want to play. It's cool. I get it. Still play it. It's great. This next game. How to move through crowds differently. Like, I literally move through crowds differently now because of this game, right? This next game stands in for a lot of other games. I don't care whether you call it Guild Wars or whatever. Look, there's people who say, I can't invest in that, man. I can't go to... You have to understand what it's like to play one of these. And I have this next one on the list. I think it's actually kind of crashed and burned at this point. So it might not be the right call. But this game is not like World War II. This game is about building another life. And, you know, maybe you're happy with the one you have, maybe you're not. But I think there's something elemental about what happens in Second Life, about creating currency, a currency that functions differently than ours in the real world. I think it's pretty good. I don't have any true alternate reality games on this list, but I do have one that I think will be around forever, and it's called Ingress. Ingress is a game you play with your phone. In the real world, there are many things, and any of them could be either red or blue, and it is absolutely crucial which of those it is. So what you do is you essentially go to a place and tag it with your color. And then other people go to that place and untag it, and violence ensues. It is the single best use of the real world in a video game I've ever seen. So I recommend that. Creative tabletop games is next. Time's Up is a game where you have you put a bunch of words into a, put some names into a hat, and then you draw them out, and then everybody comes up with a creative way to include that, and so you solve which ones the people put in. And then you do it again, except this time you can only say one word. And then you do it again, and this time you can say no words at all. And it is very hard to clue, let's say, Michael Clark Duncan without any words, but I think you can do it, right? So, highly recommend. The next game will be notable for the absence of the other game that's obviously not on this list. This was hard. How does Apples to Apples not make this list? It started this genre. Well, this game is being played more. This is the lingua franca of our world now. And I feel like Cards Against Humanity is a forever game. And I think it's very important to play. This next game might not be, it's in the same genre, but it's really different. Figuring out whether that ice flow is really the meaning of the word, you know, conflicted is very, very challenging. I don't know, I seem to be really good at this game, and I don't know why, but I think it has to do with the fact that I know this game. This one, almost nobody in this audience has played. See? 1,000 blank white cards is exactly what it sounds like. It's a game where you bring your own rules. Andy's game, Flux, changes the rules on you all the time. But at least it's only the game doing that. This is everybody brings their own game and then you play it at the same time. You find, you take a bunch of index cards, you write rules on them. If you want a card that says lose 200 points and be universally despised in Liechtenstein, that's a totally playable card and you have to work with it. All cards with monkeys are worth double. Okay, we better get some cards with monkeys because I want double. This is the single best way to spend your time if you don't have a game with you. Highly recommend. Okay. I have a category called role-playing games. This isn't technically one of them. This is a storytelling game called The Extraordinary Adventures of Baron Munchausen, where it is like this. I say to you, dear Baron, tell me about the time you crash-landed a balloon on Kilimanjaro with only three pygmies and an olive fork. And you must tell me that story. I will keep telling you things that need to be in the story. It's competitive, sort of, but it's a very different way to be creative. This next game you may not think of as a creative game, but I do think you will figure that it is creative in how you cause other people to lose at it. Now you know how to play the game. For those of you who didn't, the game is the game you cannot think about. If you think about the game, you have lost. I have made you do so, so you have lost. Now you can infect other people with this virus. All right, so before we get to number 100, I want to put some games on here that would really like to see make it. I mean, look at that list.
Master
of Orion? Yeah, no, please feel free. Now's a great time. Just fire them off. Yes, Master of Orion didn't make it. I mean, everything else. But I mean, this is a list without Metroid. This is a list without Bioshock. It's a list without Buckman and Animal. Yeah, I mean, these are hard things to leave off the list. Yeah, I mean, but they didn't make it. I mean, they're great. You should play them all. You could make another 200 list. It's great. I put them on yours, please. I'll feel better. Okay, here's the last one. You should know how to make a game. In the same way that being basketball literate, you should know how to shoot a basketball, or being music literate, you should know how to play an instrument. It doesn't matter if it's good. It doesn't matter if anybody else ever plays it. Make a game. All right, that is the list. I'm sure you think it's authoritative. On your way out, please get a copy of the handout over here. If you're walking out that door, you may not get it. So please grab it. And I will thank you guys for
stress comes in every way. I ain't got no time for nobody. My style is rich, dope, fat, and witch. We'll make a cake today that looks rich. Crack, crack, crack the egg into the bowl.
Crack, crack, crack the egg into the bowl.
M-I-X the flour into the bowl.
M-I-X the flour into the bowl.
Crack, crack, crack the egg into the bowl.
Crack, crack, crack the egg into the bowl.
M-I-X the flour into the bowl.
M-I-X the flour into the bowl.
Baking a cake, yes, means you gotta try. I'm doing this for years, but don't ask me why. Butter, butter, butter joins the bowl.
Butter, butter, butter joins the bowl.
We're making us a cake that you've never seen before.
We're making us a cake that you've never seen before.
Heat up the oven, now we're on a roll.
Heat up the oven, now we're on a roll.
Cheep, cheep, cheep's the name of my soul.
Cheep, cheep, cheep's the name of your soul.
The other day, I was called a little turkey. But I'm a chicken, got it, your beef jerky. Put the cake in the oven for a while.
Put the cake in the oven for a while.
Leave it there, come on, clean the pile.
Leave it there, come on, clean the pile.
Put the cake in the oven for a while.
Put the cake in the oven for a while.
Leave it there, come on, clean the pile.
Leave it there, come on, clean the pile.
Here, I got a little sample.
Here, I don't have a sample.
'Cause ample time's just what we don't have.
'Cause money and time's just what we don't have.
A chicken in the kitchen is making all the sound. The cake is done while we were sitting around. All we gotta do is apply the final touches.
All we gotta do is apply the final touches.
Take out the shrimp, the clam, and the perches.
Take out the shrimp, the clam, and the perches.
The perch goes here, the clam goes there.
The perch goes here, the clam goes there.
The little tiny strips just go everywhere.
The little tiny strips just go everywhere.
Whatever you like's in the middle, fiddle.
Whatever you like's in the middle, fiddle.
Seafood cake comes just like the riddle.
Seafood cake comes just like the riddle.
wasn't so hard, was it?
No problem.